SoftPC and SoftWindows were software products developed by Insignia Solutions in the late 1980s and early 1990s. Originally released for Unix, it was quickly ported to the Macintosh already by 1987. Their goal? Let non-PC platforms run DOS and Windows software without native x86 hardware.
Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories.
Running non-native software on your machine is perhaps as old a desire since the arrival of microcomputers into the mainstream. Originally, this was achieved through plug-in boards like Microsoft's SoftCard for the Apple II or the infamous CPM cartridge for the Commodore 64. Even Sun Spark workstations had their own options, the Sun PC and Sun PCI boards, effectively turning a workstation into a dual-platform machine. Performance-wise, if we ignore the CPM cartridge for a minute, these hardware-based solutions were unmatched. But they were expensive. Microsoft SoftCard retailed for $349 by 1980, that's $1,100 on the present day. Insignia Solutions took a different approach. Instead of bolting hardware onto your system, they went all in on soft emulation of the x86 CPU. It was slower, sure, but often just fast enough to get the job done. But it wasn't exactly cheap either, asking $595 in 1987, which is equivalent to a massive $1,600 today. But it eventually came down to $175 per seat by 1993, so roughly $400 in today's equivalent money. Still, a lot less you'd shell out for a full-blown PC. But how does it stack up? If I install SoftPC on this 1993 Macintosh Performa 450. The software is readily available from the Macintosh repository, and thanks to equipping the Performa 450 with the Farallon Ethermac adapter before, I could simply download the files from my local FTP server. So I went to install several releases in parallel, SoftPC with Windows 3.1 from 1993, but also SoftAT 2.52 and the much older SoftPC 1.3. Starting SoftPC 1.3, I first configured it to use the SuperDrive for Drive A, so I can seamlessly work with DOS floppy disks. I also configured the file exchange folder for Drive D, so files can be easily shared between the Mac and the DOS guest operating system. Then I pointed it at the bundled hard disk image to have it boot. And listen to the audio. It sounds very familiar, doesn't it? And then you'll end up in the bundled MS-DOS 3.3. We'll leave SoftPC 1.3 for a moment and look into SoftAT. It too asks for some configuration to be set up front, especially creating a virtual hard drive before it boots right into MS-DOS 3.3 as well. Looking into SoftPC with Windows, I first ran into an issue. It couldn't allocate enough RAM, although I stacked this machine to 20 MB because of my earlier NetBSD experiments. I found the CMOS battery, which is a half-size AA battery, needed replacement as it didn't keep the 32-bit memory setting from the control panel stored in the NVRAM. Having fixed that, SoftPC with Windows started up just fine. But wait, again, MS-DOS 3.3, and what do you mean by bad command of file name when invoking the win command? Turns out, SoftPC 3.1 uses the same configuration than SoftAT 2.52 and thus referenced the disk image of the latter. So I had to repoint SoftPC 3.1 to use its own hard disk file, which included MS-DOS 5 and Windows 3.1. Of course, the 68030 CPU of the Performa 450 isn't the fastest, so it's no surprise that booting into Windows 3.1 takes a staggering 3 minutes. Even calling up the About dialog took 30 seconds. Running solitaire, it technically works, but graphics glitches make it unplayable. At least, compared to my previous SoftWindows and Solaris demo using Sunray Terminal Services, this one is in color. And yes, Minesweeper works. Wow! SoftWindows included a background service named Smart Copy to allow for sharing the clipboard between the Mac and the guest windows. As expected, you'd use the Command C and Command V sequences on the Mac and the Control C and Control V sequences inside the emulation. However, especially inside the emulation, you'll observe noticeable delay as the buffer is copied, almost as someone would be typing it in. Remember me saying that I configured SoftPC to use the SuperDrive for Drive A in the beginning? This allows it to directly access DOS formatted floppies like this one here, which includes different versions of the Norton Utilities sysinfo program. I'm curious to see what speed index it reports. Even though this is somewhat meaningless, it still gives some idea. SystemInfo 3.1 reports this to be a 4.4 compared to the original PC, whereas SystemInfo 4.5 thinks it's a 3.8. Also, the much newer SysInfo 8.0 thinks it's a 3.8. Now, these numbers can't be fully relied upon, as this is fully emulated. A 3.8 is roughly what should be expected by an IBM PCAT with a 6 MHz 286 CPU. SoftAT 2.52 reports a 5.1 on SysInfo 3.1 and also a 5.2 on SysInfo 4.5, whereas SysInfo 8.0 stays at a computing index of 3.8. And what about SoftPC 1.3? It reports a computing index of 1.8 in both of the earlier SysInfo versions. Version 8 refuses to run, as it doesn't have a 286 emulation, but a NEC V20 CPU emulation, which is basically an enhanced pin-compatible clone of the 8088 CPU. At least, it can boot from DOS floppies, as shown here. It even boots free DOS, however, that is quite heavy already and takes several minutes to load as well. Later versions of SoftPC introduced something called SoftNode, providing some form of networking support. Definitely something I want to explore in a future episode. And what about the file exchange folder we mapped as Drive D? Yes, it lets you access files created on the Mac from the DOS side and vice versa, as long as you stick to 8.3 file names. While Insignia would later claim to deliver 486 level performance on PowerPC Macs, these 68K versions on classic hardware fall well short of that. Running Windows 3.1 in emulation is simply too much for this setup. It doesn't bring much joy. Perhaps earlier versions like Windows 286, as seen in a previous episode, would be a better fit for the Performa 450. What about you? Did you ever use SoftPC or Windows on the Mac? And if so, what for? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.